The Black Library Celebration 2021 sees the release of one of the Ultramarines' most famous heroes as the mighty Captain Uriel Ventris of the Ultramarines' 4th Company makes his way onto the Warhammer 40,000 tabletop. Inspired by the artwork on the front cover of Swords of Kalf by the equally mighty Graham McNeil, this fantastic miniature is great fun to paint, and in this video we're going to show you exactly how to paint it all the way through from start to finish. So grab your paints, your brushes, your courage and your honour, and let's get started. Now, to prepare our model for painting, we've actually assembled Uriel Ventris here into 5 different sub-assemblies. Don't worry if you've not done this yourself at home, you can absolutely paint this all as one miniature. But assembling him in 5 different sub-assemblies like this makes life really easy for 2 different reasons. First of all, it really helps when you're trying to get your brush to all those hard-to-reach places, just makes it a little bit easier to paint. Second of all, it means you can spray each sub-assembly a different colour to really help speed up the painting process. You'll notice the main body here has been attached to a spare base, while the backpack and sword arm have been pinned onto a spare flying stand using a citadel drill and a piece of paperclip. They've all been sprayed with McCrag blue spray. The head was then also pinned onto a spare flying stand and sprayed Wraithbone, while the base has been left separate and sprayed Runelord brass. Something else that's also a great idea is to keep hold of both the box and the instruction manual that came with the miniature. Both have really good pictures of the model from lots of different angles, and you can use as really good reference for painting later on. So the first paint we're going to be using here is Iron Hand Steel, which we're going to be applying to the metal areas of Uriel Ventris. Let's start off by using our medium layer brush. Let's take some Iron Hand Steel here from the pot and apply it to our palette here. Now, to help thin this down a little bit, as it's a base paint, I'm going to take a little bit of water here from our pot, just apply it then to the paint and mix it in on the palette. I'm going to load our brush up now, and then onto Uriel himself. Let's apply this onto the metal areas of the miniature. Now there's a few metal areas all over the model here. We've got this grenade on his front here. We've also got the parts of the bolt rifle that are metal here as well. Apply that now. We're also going to apply this onto the backpack vents too, but not the sword blade. We're going to come to that later on. Just make sure we're picking out all the metal parts here. Don't worry about being too messy at this stage. We're going to go back over those later on. If you want to check to make sure which parts of the model are metal, use the instruction manual pictures and the pictures on the front cover of the box as well. With the metal base coated, we've also been around the model with a pot of McCrag Blue and tidied up the armour. It's a good idea to keep a pot of McCrag Blue on hand throughout this paint job to touch up any mistakes you might make. Okay, up next, let's grab a pot of Basilicanum Grey. Now, we're going to use this contrast paint in 2 different ways. First of all, we're going to paint it all over the metal to give a really cool contrast appearance. Then we'll take a smaller brush and apply it very finely into just the recesses between the armour panels to get a nice shading effect. First of all, onto the metal. Here, grab a medium shade brush. Let's take some Basilicanum Grey here from the pot and onto our palette. Now, we're not going to thin this down at all. We just want to make sure we're not putting too much paint on the brush. There we go, that's perfect. Load it up. And now onto the metal sections. Here, we're painting this onto the metal parts we just painted on all over like so. A nice even coat of this contrast paint all over the metal, just like this. Be as careful as you can here not to hit the blue sections, but if you do, just go back with that McCrag Blue and tidy it up. Also, as you're applying the contrast paint, don't let it gather too much in the recesses and pull. Just make sure you're moving it around a little bit to make sure it gets a nice even coat all over. Next up, we've got a small layer brush here, and we've got Basilicanum Grey again. I'm going to work it into all the recesses on the blue armour, just very carefully, just picking out the blue armour sections like this. Anywhere where there's a shallow area or a recess, just very carefully painting it in like this. Now, you can see this is taking some time, and it's quite a painstaking process, but it's really worth the effort spending the time here to be as neat as you can on such a mighty hero of the Ultramarines. If you make a mistake and you go a bit over the edges, just grab that pot of McCrag Blue and tidy it up. But take your time and make sure you're hitting all the areas of blue armour, and don't forget to paint the areas on the backpack and the sword arm too. There we go, that's those areas shaded. Okay, let's highlight both areas up, and we'll start off with that famous blue armour. We'll start with a highlight of Altdorfgar Blue, then highlight with Kalgar Blue, and finally Fenrisian Grey. Then it's onto the metal, where we'll highlight first of all with Iron Hand Steel again, and then finally a highlight of Stormhost Silver. For all of these, we're going to be using our small layer brush. Let's start with the Altdorfgar Blue. Let's take some paint here from the pot and onto our palette. Now here, even though it's a layer paint, so a little bit thinner, we'll add quite a bit of water here to make sure this highlight goes on really smooth and quite subtly. I'm going to load our brush up like this. Make sure we've got a nice point on the brush. Then it's onto the miniature. Here, we're applying this highlight all over the blue parts of the armour. So just very carefully picking out the very edges of all the armour like so. Now, as Altdorf Guard Blue goes on, it'll be quite subtle when you first apply it on. So what we're going to be doing here is applying quite a... Now, when you first apply it on, the Altdorf Guard Blue will be quite subtle. So we're applying quite a chunky highlight here, quite a thick highlight, all over the blue armour like this. And again, taking our time to make sure we're just being as neat as we can and bracing our hand here against the painting handle. Paint this all over the blue sections of the armour, then it'll be time to move on to the Khalgar Blue stage. With that highlight applied, now we have another highlight going over the top of Khalgar Blue. This time, we're just being very careful and painting inside the highlight we previously applied. So really take your time here with this one. We're going for a nice thin highlight just on the very edges of all the armour panels. And last but not least, on the blue, we've got some Fenrisian Grey, which is going to add very slight highlights to the very, very edges, being super thin, just along the edge like this. Next up, we're highlighting the metal areas we painted earlier before, again with Iron Hand Steel. This time we're just providing a nice edge highlight all over these metal sections like this. Don't forget to paint the vents on the back of the backpack too, and make sure you get all the areas on Uriel's body. Then, one final highlight of Stormhost Silver on the very edges of the metal areas will help brighten up those areas. There we go, that's the blue and the metal sections done on the miniature. So let's move on to the next details, and we'll start off by painting the black areas of the miniature. This will be the joint in between Uriel's armour and also the casing on his bolt gun. Now for these areas, we'll start with a base coat of Abaddon Black. We'll then move on to highlight them with Eshin Grey and then Dawnstone. First of all, Abaddon Black. For this, grab your small airbrush as it's quite small detail. Let's take some paint from the pot here and onto our palette. Now here we are going to add a little bit of water, again, just to help thin it down. Make sure it goes on real smooth. And also make sure we get a nice point on that brush. Perfect. Then, onto the miniature. Here, what we're looking for is the joint in between his armour section. So you can see here, just around the back of the miniature, there's one here in between these sections on the legs. We're just going to paint that in black there as well. Also, look for other joints in the armour as well. We've got these sections on the chest here as well, just below the torso, just there. Go around the model, and anywhere you can see the armour joints like this, there's one on the arm here as well. Let's paint those in now. And we're also going to paint the casing on the bolt rifle too. Don't worry about that Imperial Eagle on the top of the bolt rifle. We'll be painting that in later on in gold. Now let's highlight those areas. First with Eshin Grey. Here, a nice neat edge highlight around the areas we're painting. Just very carefully working around. Use the edge of the brush if you can on the edges like this. Then over the top of this, a finer highlight of Dawnstone is applied. So just along the absolute edges of all these black areas. So there we go, that's the black areas painted. Okay, up next, let's have a look at painting the brown leather on Uriel Ventris. This will be his belt, his pistol holster, and of course that brown leather hanging from his waist. For this, we'll start off with a base coat of Rhinox Hide. We'll then wash those areas with Nuln Oil before moving on to highlight them first with Gorthor Brown and then Baneblade Brown. First of all, that Rhinox Hide. Grab your small airbrush again for this one. Let's take some paint from the pot and again onto our palette here. A little bit of water again for a base paint, just helps thin it down. Then it's onto our miniature. And here we're applying this onto those leather areas. So we've got these leather strips hanging from his waist here. We've also got his belt here as well, which you can just see here behind these armour plates. And don't forget, of course, the holster for his pistols hanging from his waist here as well. All right, next up, let's put some Nuln Oil over the top of this to shade it all down. This is going over all the leather areas we just painted. It's a nice even layer. With the wash dry, we've now got some Gorthor Brown, and here we're highlighting the very edges of the leather sections here. We'll do the same again on the belt and of course the holster too. Then the next highlight is Baneblade Brown. Here it's being applied very thinly, just on the very edges of the leather sections like so. And when we've done this, we're going to go back and pick out the studs on this leather with Iron Hand Steel. There we go, that's the leather section to the miniature complete. Okay, up next, let's paint the gold all over Uriel Ventris. And as he's a mighty Ultramarines captain, there's quite a bit of gold. We'll start off with a base coat of Retributor armour, then we'll apply Gilliman Flesh over the top of it to shade it down. Then we'll add layers of Retributor armour and Liberator gold before highlighting with Stormhost silver. First of all, grab your small airbrush, as these details are quite small. Let's take some Retributor armour from the pot now and onto our palette. Now, Retributor armour is a metallic paint, so we don't need to thin it down too much, but a touch of water will help make it go on real smooth. Load the brush up, and then onto Uriel Ventris. Here, we're applying this onto all the golden areas on the model. As you can expect, there's quite a lot of this, so have a really good look at the instruction manuals and the image on the box to help you out with this. But make sure we're getting a nice, even layer of gold over every area, so picking out the trim, the aquila on his chest here, there's a big Ultima symbol on his waist as well, we'll pick that out too. All the different bits of trim and markings all over the body, just pick all of these out now with gold. Take your time on this one, to be as neat as you possibly can. With that base coat down, we're now applying a contrast paint over the top. This is Gilliman Flesh. We're applying it nice and heavily all over the gold to get a really cool contrast look. Next up, we've got Retributor armor back out again. Here we've thinned it down with a touch of water so it goes on quite subtly. And now it's providing a layer over the top of what we've applied. What we're doing here is we're leaving the recessed areas the original color we've previously painted. I'm just painting this new lighter color onto the raised areas like this. Up next, we've got Liberator Gold, and here again, we're applying a layer over the top, just picking out the raised areas on the gold here. So again, just leaving those recessed areas the original colour, and leaving a little bit of the Retributor armour showing as well. Last but not least, on the gold, here applying a highlight of Stormhost Silver on the very edges of all the golden areas. On some areas like this, up on the collar, we can use the edge of the brush to get a nice sharp highlight. On other areas, just use the other parts of the brush to get a nice fine highlight of silver. Not too much here, don't make it silver. It's very, very fine edge highlights. There we go, that's the gold sections complete. Okay, up next, let's have a look at painting the various greens on this miniature. We're going to start off by painting the bright green that is the famous 4th Company shoulder pad rims. For this, we'll start off with a base coat of Warp Stone Glow, followed by a simple highlight of Scarsnet Green. Now for this we're swapping over to the sword arm subassembly, but of course don't forget to paint both shoulder pad rims at the same time. Grab your small airbrush for this one. Let's take some paint from the pot and onto our palette here. Now here we are going to add a little bit of water to help thin it down. Just make sure it goes on real smooth. Make sure we've got a nice point on the brush as well, so this is quite fine detail. Then onto the miniature. Here we're providing a nice even base coat all over the shoulder pad rims like so. Just work your way around very carefully here, being super careful not to hit any of the blue detail you've already painted. But don't forget, you can always correct it with McCrag Blue paint if you need to. Next up, we're applying a very fine highlight with Scarsnet Green. Here we can use the edge of the brush to pick out just the very edges of the shoulder pad like this. So there we go. We took our time to be nice and neat, and that's the shoulder pad rim highlights complete. Okay, up next, let's have a look at painting Uriel Ventris' green cloak. Now we'll start with a slightly darker outside of the cloak first of all, and for this we'll start with a base coat of Cabalite Green. Grab your medium base brush for this. Let's take some paint from the pot here and again onto our palette. Now Cabalite Green is a little thinner than other paints, so we're going to water it down a touch, but not too much to help smooth it out. Just a little bit of water. There we go. And load the brush up and onto the back of the cloak. Here we're looking for a nice even base coat all over the back of the cloak. You'll see straight away that the chances are we'll need a couple of coats to get a nice solid colour. Not a problem at all. Let the first coat dry and then apply a second coat. Also, you can see at this point the advantage of leaving the backpack off as a separate sub-assembly, as it's making the cloak a lot easier to paint. There we go, we have a nice solid base coat of Cabalite Green to work over. Okay, up next, let's shade down the recesses of that cloak, but for this, we're going to make our own wash using Lupercal Green mixed with Larmian Medium. Once we've done that, we'll do the same again with Inky by Darkness, again mixed with Lamy Medium for the deepest recesses. Then once that's done, we'll put a simple highlight on top of the cloak with Cyberite Green. Now first of all, let's make that Lupercal Green and Lamy and Medium mix. I have a medium layer brush for this one. What I'm going to do here is just take one brush full of Lupercal Green, we don't need too much, and put it onto our palette here. A bit more, there we go, just like that. Then we're going to wash our brush off to make sure there's absolutely no paint left there at all. Bit of tissue paper, there we go. Now, with the Lamy Medium, I'm going to take a few brushfuls out here and apply it to the palette as well. What I'm looking for here is to create a sort of same consistency as a shade paint. So I'm going to get three brushfuls first of all and see if that's enough. Mix that together. There we go, that's absolutely perfect. There we go. I'm going to load the brush up like so. And here, when we've got that on our brush, onto the miniature, going to apply this now into the recesses of the cloak. Just the recesses, mind, not the raised areas. Now, this is going to go on quite subtle, but once it's dry, the shade will be really apparent. If you want a bit more of a shading effect, you can always add multiple coats here. We're just applying it nice and thickly to all the recessed areas like so. You'll get a nice blend down from the cabalite green into the recesses with this. Then we've done the same again with Inky by Darkness. And here with a small airbrush, we're just putting it into the absolute deepest recesses of the cloak. Again, the first time this goes on, it'll be quite subtle, but you can build up the colour with multiple layers to create a nice deep shade in that cloak. With the shades done, we've now thinned down some Cybrite Green with water, and using a small layer brush, we're going to apply a nice fine highlight all over the very ridges of the cloak, like this. There we go, that's the outside of the cloak complete. Okay, up next, let's paint the inner cloak. Now here we're going to start off with a base coat of Warboss Green. Once that's been applied, we've got a nice solid base coat. We'll then take some Cabalite Green and Lamia Medium and do as we did before, create our own wash with that and shade it into the recesses. Then we'll take some Scarsnet Green and use Lamia Medium again, but not quite as much this time. And this time we're going to be creating a sort of layer and a nice subtle layer to make a nice smooth blend up. Then we'll take some Nurgling Green and put a final highlight onto the cloak. So first of all, it's time for that Warboss Green. Grab a medium layer brush here, and let's take some paint from the pot and onto the palette. Now here, it's super important to get a nice smooth base coat. So we're going to take some water here and add it to the Warboss Green just to help thin it down, and then onto our miniature. Here, we're applying this onto the inside of the cloak like this. We're going to be giving it a nice couple of coats to get a good, smooth, solid base coat. You can see here the advantage of leaving the sword arm as a separate sub-assembly, as it means we can get our brush now to all the parts of the cloak. With that nice solid base coat applied, we've now got some Cabalite Green heavily thinned down with Larmian Medium. And here, as before, we're just painting it carefully into the recesses of the cloak. Now you can see again, as it goes on, it's going to be quite subtle. So you can build up the layers of this if you want to create a nice darker tone deeper down in the recesses. Next up, we're painting a layer of Scarsnet Green. Here we've mixed it with Larmian Medium to make sure it goes on really smooth and subtle, provide a nice smooth transition up from the base paint. So here we're just picking out the raised areas of the cloak like this, just making sure we're leaving the lower areas and the recesses the darker colours. And then finally on the inside of the cloak we've got some Nurgling Green which we thinned down with a touch of water, and now we're just painting very fine lines on the absolute ridges and highlights of the inner of the cloak. So there we go, that's the inside of the cloak painted. Okay, up next, let's grab a pot of Inky by Darkness and paint the key line around the very bottom and edge of the cloak. For this, we need our absolute smallest small airbrush. Let's take some of the paint here and onto the palette. Now here, to make sure it goes on real smooth, I'm going to thin it down with a touch of water and also make sure we've got a nice point on the brush as this is very fine detail. Then onto Uriel himself. Here, we're just going to very carefully pick out the key line around the bottom of the cloak like this. Just take our time. There we go. Super fine like this. Just all the way around the bottom, like so. There we go, that's the key line painted in. Okay, up next, let's have a look at painting the various white symbols and sigils around the miniature, such as the Ultima symbol on Uriel's shoulder pad, as well as other small bits of the model as well. Now for these, we're going to start off with a base coat of Corax White. Then over the top of that, we'll apply a contrast paint, Apothecary White, mixed with a touch of contrast medium to help thin it down a bit. Then we'll layer back up again with Corax White before finally highlighting with White Scar. First of all, grab your medium layer brush for this. Let's take some Corax White from the pot now and onto our palette. Now here, it's quite a thin paint, but we are going to add a little bit of water just to make sure it's going on really smooth. There we go, perfect. Then onto the miniature. Now here we're painting onto the Ultima symbol on the shoulder pad, but of course, make sure you're painting all the details on the model at the same time. Be super neat and careful here. Just taking our time to make sure we're not hitting any other part of the model. But of course, if you do, just grab that pot of McCrag Blue and tidy up. With a solid base coat applied, we've now got some Apothecary White, which we've thinned down with contrast medium. Now painting it over the top like so to get a nice subtle shade on all the white symbols. Next up, back to Corax White, and here applying a layer towards the top of those symbols. So on the Ultima symbol, for example, just towards the top of the U like this. Then we've got some white scar, and here applying it to the very edges of each of these white symbols and sigils around the miniature. There we go, that's the white symbols complete. Okay, up next we're going to be painting the purity seals, and a hero like Uriel Ventris has a good number of these on the miniature. I'm going to start off by painting the cloth part of the purity seals with a base coat of Rakarth flesh. Then we'll place a contrast paint over the top, skeleton horde, mixed with a touch of contrast medium to help thin it down. Then we'll layer back up with Karak stone before finally highlighting with a shanty bone, and then we'll put the writing over the top with a Abaddon black. But more on that in a bit. First of all, that base coat of Rakarth flesh. Grab your small airbrush for this one again. Let's take some paint from the pot and onto our palette. You know the drill by now, a little bit of water to help thin it down. Perfect. Then onto the miniature. Now there's quite a lot of purity seals all over the model, so make sure you're picking them all out. Just going to show you how this one works on the arm here. But have a really good look around the whole model, as there's quite a few. Make a nice even base coat all over the cloth sections. And again, be neat here. Don't hit any other parts of the model if you can possibly avoid it. There we go. Then over the top of this, we've got some Skeleton Horde contrast paint, which we've mixed with a touch of contrast medium, about 1:1 on the mix. We're applying a nice liberal coat over the top. Next up, we've got Karak stone, and here we're applying it as a layer over the top. Slightly thinned it down with a touch of water to make sure it goes on real thin. Just picking out the raised areas of the purity seal cloth like this. Then we've got some Ashabti bone. Here we've thinned it down with a touch of water, and we're just applying a quick highlight on the edge of each of the purity seal cloths like this. With that done, we've now got some Abaddon black. We've thinned it down with a touch of water, and we're just going to paint little tiny little lines across our purity seals like this, like squiggly lines, to make it look like there's writing on it. There we go, that's the cloth of the purity seals done. But now let's move on to painting the red on the miniature. So that's the wax of the purity seals, but also the haft of the sword, the gem on the sword, and the rope hanging down from his backpack too. We're going to paint all of these at the same time, as they're going to use the same colours. We'll start off by base coating all of those areas with Galvor Back Red. Then we'll layer on top with Mephiston Red before highlighting with Fire Dragon Bright. Then on the gem, we'll paint a coat of Arco Gloss Varnish to make it look all shiny. First of all, it's that Galvor Back Red. Grab your small layer brush again. Let's take some paint from the pot and onto our palette. As you know by now, a little bit of water for a base paint just to help thin it down. Then onto the miniature. Here, we're painting the red areas. So we've got the Purity Seal Wax right here. We're also going to paint the haft of the sword here as well, and the gem on the sword. There's a gem on the other side as well, so make sure we get both. And don't forget to paint the rope hanging down from the backpack at the same time. Next up, we've got Mephiston Red, and here we're using it as a layer to pick out the raised areas of these red parts. So here on the purity seal, don't forget the weapon haft here, just leaving the little hatching in between parts like that. When it comes to painting the gem, just concentrate your layer towards one end of the gem like so, leaving one end of the gem dark like that. Then we've got Fire Dragon Bright to provide just a quick highlight around these areas, so just around the edge of the purity seals like this. On the gem, just highlight the end you've put the lighter red on, so just this one highlight towards the end like this, and then one simple reflection dot on the other side of the gem down there, and then also highlight the edges of each of the hatchings like so. Then we're painting some Ardco gloss varnish onto the gems on the sword pommel. So there we go, that's the red sections complete. Okay, up next let's have a look at painting the blade of the famous sword of Adeus, and for this we'll start off with a base coat of Iron Hand steel all over the blade. Grab your medium layer brush again for this. Let's take some paint from the pot, and as always, onto our palette. A little bit of water here to thin it down. Now, it's really important here on the sword blade to get a nice smooth base coat to make it look like nice smooth steel. So we're going to apply a little bit of water here and make sure it goes on in multiple coats. Then onto the blade. Here we go. We're looking for nice long brush strokes going down the length of the blade like so. We're looking for absolutely no imperfections here, so just make sure you're taking your time to get a nice smooth coat. Now, you may need a couple of coats to get a nice strong colour here. That's absolutely fine, just let that first one dry and apply the second. Painting of the power nodes at the bottom here as well, and making sure we're avoiding painting the golden bits we've already painted. There we go, that's a nice even base coat of Ironhand steel all over that blade. So let's move on to the next stage. And here we're going to be painting a few glazes on top of that blade to help darken down the tip, just like we see in the heavy metal paint job on the box cover. Now for this we're going to be using Basilicana and Grey contrast paint and mixing it with contrast medium loads to create a glaze. Here's how we're going to do it. Grab your medium layer brush again for this one. Now let's take one brush full of Basilicana and Grey here and put it onto our palette like so. Then thoroughly wash our brush off, make sure there's no paint left there at all. Do the tissue paper there, just make sure it's nice and clean. Then we're going to take some contrast medium. Now here, I'm just going to make a sort of judgment as I go. Maybe about three brushfuls to start with. And see if that's enough. Let's have mix that in. We're looking for a really, really thin down paint. Yep, that's absolutely perfect. There we go. So what we're going to do here is load our brush up. Make sure there's not too much. And then onto the blade. Now what we're doing here is providing a glaze. So rather than sort of washing it over, we're just going to go for a nice smooth coat like this, just along the entire length of the blade. Now it's going to be super subtle as it goes on, but it provides a little bit of shading around the power node and also help darken down the whole blade as we go. Now we're going to be doing multiple layers of this, so we're going to let this one dry and we'll come back in a second and paint some more over the top. With that first glaze dry, we're now going to start successively adding more glazes to this blade and just starting a bit further down as we go. So the first glaze here is going to go nearer the end like this. And as we go, and this one dries, we'll then add another one over the top, starting a bit further down, and eventually we'll get a nice darkening effect going towards the end of the blade. All of these are going to be really subtle, so we've got a really nice thin down Basilicana and Grey here. It's keeping it nice and thinned on our palette. So here I've painted about six layers of this glaze, working steadily down towards the end of the blade. You can see the end of the blade is a lot darker here. Now I'm just going to add one final glaze at the very tip here, just to darken that down a little bit. Again, super thin down Basilicana and Grey, just like it has been all the way through. And now, after that, we've got this nice blend towards the tip. There we go, that's the glazes applied onto the blade, giving this really cool blended effect. Okay, up next, let's brighten the sword up by first highlighting the edges with Ironhand steel. Then we'll take Ethematic Blue contrast paint to create a sort of power effect around the power nodes. And then finally we'll highlight the entire blade and the power nodes very carefully with Stormhost Silver. First of all, Ironhand steel. Again, grab your small layer brush here. Let's take some paint from the pot here. Now, this highlight wants to be super subtle. So here we're going to be thinning this down quite a bit with water. Just make sure it goes on real smooth. There we go. That's perfect. Then onto the miniature. Here, we're going to be using the edge of the brush very carefully to highlight the edges of the blade. So make sure you find the flat of the brush. There it is. Then run it along the edge of the blade like so, just subtly picking up the very edges like this, just to help pick them out. And once you get to the top of the blade here, we're also going to be painting the center of the blade here. So just very carefully with your brush, just drag it up the center like so, just to pick out that ridge of the sword blade. Next up, we've got Ethematic Blue, and here we're painting it around the power nodes towards the hilt of the sword, like so, to create a sort of glowing power effect around them. Now, this is quite thin paint, so the effect will be quite subtle with one layer, so you can add as many layers as you like, building it up if you want to. I'm probably going to add about two here to give a really cool glowing effect. Then finally, on the blade, we're going to add a highlight of Stormhost Silver. Now again, we thin this down with water. Just going to run it along the absolute edges of the blade towards the top like so. Maybe a bit heavier towards the tip here. And do the same around the other side too. We're also going to pick out the power nodes at the bottom as well with this. Just a nice quick little coat on top just to pick them out to make them shine like that. There we go, that's the blade of the sword complete. Okay, up next it's time to paint Uriel Ventris's head. Now here we've mounted it onto a spare flying stand, as I explained earlier, and sprayed it Wraithbone. However, if you've actually assembled your miniature and the head is attached, just make sure you're giving a nice flat coat of Wraithbone paint out of a pot all over the head first, before we move on. The first thing we're going to be doing is applying a contrast paint all over the flesh, Gilliman Flesh, aptly, which we're going to apply using our medium shade brush. Let's take some Gilliman Flesh from the pot here and onto our palette. Now here, we're not thinning this down at all. We are making sure we're not overloading the brush with way too much paint. Just getting a nice amount on the brush there. Okay, onto the face. Here, we're applying this good even coat of this Gilliman Flesh all over Uriel Ventris's face like so. Now, something to look out for here as you're applying a contrast paint like this is to not let it gather together in the recesses too much and pull. So we're just going to be making sure we're moving the paint around as it goes on to make sure it doesn't gather together. See here at the top here by the service studs? I'm going to poke that with a brush to make sure it's a nice even layer like that. Don't worry too much at this point about hitting other parts of the head. We're going to go back later on and paint those too. There we go. The contrast paint has dried. Just look at the effect it's already had on the flesh. Okay, let's add some more definition to the face by adding some layers and highlights. Now we'll start with a layer of Kislev flesh, very thin down to make it nice and subtle. Then we'll add a highlight of Flaybond flesh, and finally a touch of a highlight of Screaming Skull. First of all, Kislev flesh. Grab your small airbrush here. Let's take some paint from the pot and onto our palette. We're only on a small amount here, just a little bit. That's all we need. But we are going to thin it down quite a bit with water so it goes on really translucent and smooth. There we go, that's perfect. Then onto the face. Here, we're adding a very, very small, subtle layer onto the raised areas of the face. So just picking out the raised parts like this, just to help define them like so. You can see we're just picking out the bridge of the eyes and the mouth, also the cheekbones here like this, leaving quite a lot of the original color already underneath. Be nice and subtle with this and apply the paint quite lightly and you'll get a really nice smooth flesh appearance. Then up next we've got Flayed One flesh, and here again we're providing a bit of a layer over the top but just leaving some of the Kislev flesh already showing. So again we've thinned it down with a little bit of water here, make sure it goes on real smooth and subtle, and just picking out the highlights like this. Then finally we have the tiniest amount of Screaming Skull, just a dot on the various highest places on the face, so the absolute tip of the nose here for example. We'll go around the bridge of the eyes with this too, and other areas just to bring a bit more definition to the face. There we go, that's the flesh tones complete. Up next, let's add some more colours to the flesh. First of all, by adding some stubble using Eschen Grey mixed with Lamian Medium. Once that's dry, we'll then pick out the bottom lip with Karaberg Crimson. First of all, let's make that stubble. Grab your small airbrush for this. Now, let's take some Eschen Grey here. We only need a little amount, so not too much from the pot, just onto our palette here. Now, again, we're going to wash our brush off, make sure there's absolutely nothing left on there at all. Then we're going to be taking some Lamian Medium here from the pot and onto the palette. Now, I'm going to take about two brushfuls here. We're looking to kind of create a glaze, as we did earlier on with the Basilicana and Grey. There we go. Ah, do you know what? That's absolutely perfect. Brilliant. So, we're going to load our brush up. Then, onto the face. Here, we're applying this as a glaze in the areas the stubble would be. So around the bottom of the face here, like so, just like this, nice and subtle. Don't apply it too heavily. It wants to be quite subtle when it goes on. Just like this, around the bottom of the face here and the chin, around the other side of the face too. We're also going to apply this at the bottom of the hair where it meets the face to look like he shaved his head. Then we're picking out the bottom lip with Karaberg Crimson, just the bottom lip here, to help pick it out like this. There we go. There we go, that's the lip painted. We also put a little bit of Karaberg Crimson into that scar on his forehead too. Okay, up next, let's pick out the rest of the areas on the head. Now we're going to base coat all of the areas on the head with Abaddon Black. So that's the neck, the hair, the metal plate, the armour bits around the back of the head, and the eyes too. Once we've done that, we'll then highlight the hair and the neck with Eschen Grey, and then followed by Dawnstone on those two areas as well. First of all, Abaddon Black. Grab your small airbrush for this. Let's take some paint from the pot and onto our palette here. Now here we're looking to make sure we've got an absolutely super fine point on the brush, as we're using very small detail, so we're making sure that our paint is nice and smooth with water as well. And then onto the model. So here we're looking to paint every part of the miniature that's not flesh. So picking out the hair, the metal bits at the back, and then the eyes and other parts of the miniature as well that are not flesh. Just pick those all out now, and we'll move on to the next stage. Up next, we've got Eschen Grey. Here we've thinned it down with a touch of water, and now we're using it to highlight the hair and the piping around the neck as well. So here we're just picking out individual hairs and things, just making it look like there's hair effects on the head by picking out the highest bits like this. There we go. Perfect, leaving that black there in the recesses, of course. And down here on the neck, we're just going to be picking out the raised areas of the piping as we did with the joints in between the armour earlier on. Then once that's done, it's a highlight of Dawnstone on the very tips of the hair and just around the very edges too, just to help highlight that up. There we go, that's the black of the hair and the piping around the neck complete. Right, up next, let's paint the whites over the eyes. And here we're using Corax White, our absolutely smallest layer brush as well. Now, here we have some Corax White. We're just going to take a tiny amount on the end of the brush. We're not going to use our palette here. Just going to dot on the end of the brush, just the smallest amount like that. Perfect. Then onto the model. Here, brace yourself against the paint handle like so, and then very carefully paint a dot either side of the pupil like this. There we go, just like that. Now we're going to do this on both eyes, and once that's done, we're going to go back and paint the rest of the head using techniques seen earlier in this video. So there we go, that's the head complete now with all the parts of the head done. You can see we've got the blue at the back there, the bits of metal. We've also got a metal plate at the side of the head here, and the service studs too. Okay, so that's the head done. Now it's time to move on to the last bit of the miniature, and that's the base. Now we assembled our base separately and sprayed it with RuneLore Brass Spray. But again, if you've assembled your model completely and stuck the model to the base, just give the base a good coat of RuneLore Brass now. Once that's done, the first thing to be doing over the top of that is applying a layer of Cryptek Armour Shade Gloss as a wash. So grab your medium shade brush for this. Let's take some paint from the pot and onto our palette here. Now with this paint, we're just going to make sure we haven't got too much on the brush, but we do want quite a bit. So there we go, perfect in the middle, bang on. Then on top of the base here, it's a nice liberal coat of this all over the top of the base like so. And once that's dry, it'll give a really cool shaded brass appearance. So there we go, that's the shade dry, giving this really cool appearance on top of the base. All right, let's add some more colours now. As first, we're going to be dry brushing over the top of that with RuneLord Brass. Then we'll dry brush over the top again with Canoptic Alloy before getting that Cabalite Green and Lumion Medium mix we used earlier on the inside of the cloak and applying it to the rivets and some of the gaps to make it look like verdigris. First of all, it's that RuneLord Brass dry brush. Grab your medium dry brush for this. Let's take some paint from our pot here and onto a piece of tissue paper we have prepared. Now here we're basically going to be brushing off just about all of the paint onto the tissue paper. Just work that paint in there like so. We want very little paint left on the brush. That's why it's called dry brushing. Then onto the base here, we're applying this dry brush all over the top like so. Just using nice big strokes like this. And you'll notice as the dry brush goes on, it'll be quite faint to start with, but you can build up the colours you want, that all the edges start getting picked out with the RuneLord Brass colour, giving this really cool appearance. Then another dry brush over the top, this time with Canoptic Alloy. So it's a little bit of a lighter colour here, so you'll really see the edges of these panels on the base brought out. Last but not least, on the top of the base here, we've got some Cabalite Green mixed with Lamium Medium. That's the same mix we made earlier on for the inside of the cloak. Now we're going to pick out a few of the rivets here and a few of the details to make it look like verdigris is forming on the top of the brass. Once we've done this, we're going to paint the rim of the base with Steel Legion Drab, and then it's time to assemble the miniature, cutting all the pieces off of their sub-assemblies and assembling it with super glue. There we go, the base is painted and the miniature has been assembled. And with that, Captain Uriel Ventris is ready to lead the 4th Company of Ultramarines to war on the tabletop. So that's how you can paint your Captain Ventris miniature from the Black Library Celebration 2021. A couple of things to remember here. First of all, if you can assemble the miniature in the sub-assemblies we showed at the start, it'll make life a lot easier when coming to paint the model. That's the same really when it comes to painting any intricate model such as a hero like this. Second of all, this is a beautiful miniature and it's really worth taking your time. So be as neat as you possibly can and be patient and the results will tell at the end. I hope you've enjoyed this video. March from a crag and no fear.